Members, we have reached the appointed hour and the quorum is present. I'll call the meeting to order. We have a long agenda, so we need to manage time strictly. Every member will be able to have 4 minutes for questions and answers. I don't think I can allow more time for the elaborations. Item number one, confirmation of minutes. The Secretariat hasn't received any proposed amendments. Do members want to propose any amendment now? If not, minutes are confirmed. Item two, information paper issued since the last meeting. The list is set out on the agenda. Please take note. Item three, question, any question? If not, question number three, items for discussion at the next meeting. For list of follow-up action, please refer to the list. And also there's a list of outstanding items for discussion for the next meeting. We're going to discuss the work of the sales of first-hand residential properties authority and increasing the number of commercial units and set up holiday bazaars in PRH estates. And another item is on the excessive charges imposed on operators of welfare facilities operating in a retail facility in the PRH estates. Well, Mr. Chang Han Pan has referred to the problems in the old forms of a PRH application because it does not cover policy as assets. But there are people who purchase a life insurance, but then subsequent years later they found out that it has a cash value, it has an investment value, and their qualifications for PRH was cancelled. It's raised by Mr. Chan Han Pan. Can we have a discussion earlier? Yeah, we have received a letter from Mr. Chan Han Pan. We have referred the letter to the Housing Bureau for an answer. Transport and Housing Bureau for an answer. We have a very long list and we don't have much time since before July. Let's see if we can extend the meeting time. Because that item alone would at least take us 3 hours. Well, I will ask the Secretariat to look into possibility of a time of extension of meeting time. All right. Well, it's urgent because many applicants have their qualification cancelled. Item four. Public Works Program, items number B722CL, B289RS, and B187TB, Infrastructure, Community and Transport Facilities to Support Public Housing Developments at Sham Shui Po, Kwun Tong, and Tuen Mun. And we can now invite the officials to join us.
歡迎各位代表出席會議，請政府代表看看介紹你們的電腦投影片，因為時間關係，希望大家掌握時間精簡。
多謝主席，各位委員好，我和大家今天介紹三項有關基建、社區和運輸設施的工務計劃。
以配合在深水埗、觀塘和屯門的公營房屋發展的。那這三個項目呢，就是今天的文件就是請議員支持我們將三項公務計劃是提升為甲級啦，去配合那三個地區的公營房屋。那個三個項目呢，分別就是深水埗西北九龍填海區一號地盤那個第一期的拆卸和土地淨化工程。觀塘
We have B722CL Demolition and Ground Decontamination Work for Development at Northwest Kowloon Reclamation Site 1 and two other items. To address the housing need of the community, we need to take forward the proposed PWP projects to provide land and supporting facilities for public housing developments. The first one is demolition and ground decontamination works for development at Northwest Kowloon Reclamation Site 1, Sumshui Po, Phase 1. The site is the Cheongsa Wan Abattoir, and this would provide land for Northwest Kowloon Reclamation Site 1. The parts of these of the project proposed to be upgraded to Category 1, including demolition of existing buildings and structures and ground decontamination work at the ex-abattoir site and adjoining work area of the government departments. The second project involves the of the first site project involves the demolition of the previous vegetable marketing facility, and the decontamination works is necessary for because asbestos has been found and there and heavy metals have also been detected, so that we need to carry out the contamination works. This is not a EIA project. We have conducted the initial assessment. After it's done, it will be handed over to the housing department for providing 2,400 units. So we need to tie in with the proposed public housing project. In February, we got the support of the Sumshui Po District Council. The cost now, the estimated capital cost is $108.4 million, money of the day prices. If this is supported, we would submit this item to the PwC and FC for approval. If funding approval is given, we will commence the work at the end of this year and the completion date is early 2018. The next project is the sports center at Choi Wing Road, Kun Tong. This is on the provision about the provision of a sports center at the platform of Phase 3 of the public housing development at Choi Fook Estate. This is Choi Fook Estate, Phase 3, and the location of the sports center is indicated here on this plan. The facilities will include multi-purpose May games area, indoor jogging track, and multi-purpose activity rooms, table tennis room, fitness room, children's play room, and ancillary facilities such as baby care room to meet the needs of different uses. And there will be automatic wind glass doors for easy access by the disabled. The access will be barrier-free. This is the cross-section of the proposed sports center and the topside public housing development. This is to address the needs of the increasing population for sports facilities arising from the PRH development at Choi Phuc Estate Phase 3 and other new public housing developments in the area. About 1,000 units can be provided through the PRH project. Apart from the sports center, the HA will provide a wet market with 42 stores to address the needs of the local population. There are 8 sports centers in Kwun Tong. The utilization rate is more than 80%. We need to build a 9th one to address the needs of the population there, so we need this project. On consultation, we have consulted the Kwun Tong District Council, it's a housing committee, and it's a traffic and transport committee. The members support the projects and they support the early implementation of this project. And money of the day prices, the cost, capital cost is $609.6 million. And if the panel members support this council, the item will be submitted to the PWSC and the FC for approval this year. Once it's approved, work will commence in early 2017 for completion in early 2021. And the sports center, will, after construction, will be handed over to LCSD for management. The third one is an improvement project to a footbridge. There will be a lift tower installed, a lift will be installed, linking up Siu Hong Road, PTI, and West Rail, Siu Hong Station. This will make it convenient for passengers to go to the PTI and the Siu Hong Station of West Rail. Nearby, the Area 54, there will be a number of public rental housing projects. For example, Site 2, 4,600 units will be provided. Most of the tenants will be using the footbridge to go to Siu Hong Station to cope with the additional people flow that need to do the improvement and to install lifts. The footbridge is 13 meters above ground and there's no barrier-free access. That's why we have proposed to install a lift to make sure that the access is barrier-free. We'll consult the Environmental Hygiene and District Development Committee of Tuen Mun District Council. Members support the project and its early implementation. There's no need to do the gazetto through the road traffic ordinance because we have not received any objection after the project is gazetted. The estimated capital cost at money of the day prices is $109.5 million. With the endorsement of this panel, we're going to submit the project item to the PWSC and FC within this legislative session. If funding approval is approved, it will be commenced in late 2016 to be completed in mid-2019. The footbridge after improvement will be handed over to Transport Department and the Sea and Highways Department for maintenance. Members are invited to support the three PWP projects.
So members, if you have any direct or indirect interest involved in the project, please, based on Section 83A, please declare them before you speak. And please note that 84A of the Rules of Procedures for any pecuniary or direct and indirect interest, you need to take note of the provision there. So now it's time for members to ask questions. Tommy Chung, Helena Wong, Tam Yu Chung, Chen Wei Chun, Lo Wai Kwok, Chen Ken Lam have asked to speak. Who else? Each will have 4 minutes, including the answer. Tommy Jung first. Thank you. I don't need 4 minutes. I'd just like to wish the administration good luck. If you can have this item passed, that would be good. Otherwise, we have to wait. Queue up again next year. Liberal Party supports all these three projects. By 289, when I was in the Municipal Council, I for all these sports complex or sports center, I always found that when I go there, these sports centers, the lightings are for all sorts of sports. But when you play badminton, you find that the lighting is too bright. When you play basketball, you find that it's not bright enough. When you play volleyball, you wish to have other kinds of lighting. So at the design level, could you arrange so that people can have all eight badmintons in use, and you can actually arrange for the lighting actually used for different purposes. You don't have to answer me. I'm just trying to give you a view on proper lighting for different sports activities. But nonetheless, I support these three public works programs. Ms. Fong, thank you. We will, based on your suggestions, design the lighting in the new sports center, including this one and the last one we submitted. We would actually adopt that, the approach you suggested in terms of lighting design. Next one, Helena Wong. I've got a question on the Shenshipo Northwest, the ground decontamination works there. I know that you want to build public rental housing in the former abattoir, Chengsha 1 abattoir. I think policy-wise, I don't quite agree that we should mix residential area with a wholesale market. In the Shem Shui Po, or as you can see in this area, there are lots of wholesale markets scattered in the residential area. In the Food and Environmental Hygiene panel, well, I don't always come here to this panel, but since you're here, I'd like to talk to you. The livestock wholesale market in Shem Shui Po is surrounded by residential buildings, and they really find the wholesale market a nuisance and unhygienic. You can't have livestock and human beings living together. We're not in a rural area. So people like to see the wholesale market removed. So why don't you, move these wholesale markets away from residential areas and use the vacated site to build housing? And now the government, rather than solving the issue, you're creating a new problem now. This sort of site, I keep looking at the map, I found it difficult. Surrounding it is the Shenshan Wan wholesale vegetable market and loading and loading area. And there's also the premium vegetable packaging center. The Food and Environmental Hygiene panel went there for a visit. We need to make a roundabout route to arrive at the site. And you want to take out a particular plot of land. I don't know whether you've been to the wholesale market. The car trucks arrive at the site at the crack of dawn. And many vegetable sellers go there very early in the morning to get produce for sale later on. That means very early in the morning, the trucks will go to the wholesale market. And now you want to build public rental housing there. What measures have you got to avoid nuisance to the residents? There could be light pollution and noise pollution because you are putting people, in the same neighborhood with these markets. Deputy Director, thank you. I think in terms of planning, the government has suggestions on, for example, we can move the wholesale market in due course. We can also see from here that for the ex-Chengshawan abattoir, after it's demolished, the site will be developed. And a part of it, you can see. I know, Ada, I know. I can see from your plan. what will be there. But if you told me that you would move the wholesale market, why don't you do it now? Why would you move it? All along, we've hoped to develop the lot in one go. But it takes time for the wholesale market to be removed because you need to find a new location yet. Still. So it may take quite a long time for it to be relocated. When do you expect to move the wholesale market to? I think when the time is appropriate, when the planning department have got any idea, I think they can give you the information. But back to the Cheung Shopman Abattoir, it is dilapidated and needs to be demolished. And then at this site, we can build the public rental housing instead. And the Lai Chi Kok Road, PRH, and also across the street from Tongking Street, there are also public rental housing estates being built. So we can hope that we can sort of create a cluster of estates. I understand, but I hope that before you submit the idea to PWSC, please include your other related plans, because otherwise we can't, the Democratic Party cannot support this capital works. Unless you tell me where the Cheung Shui Wan wholesale market will be moved to. You know, fruit market in Yeo Ma Tei is still a problem. I would suggest that the fruit market be moved to this site and then you build a PRH in the fruit market site instead. Can you get some explanations ready first before you submit the paper again? If you take away, you know, a site that could be used to reprovision the vegetable market, then that could be a problem. Is it that Cohen Man says that it's okay for you to take up the site concerned? Site number 6 has been used for PRH. So this site in your proposal, can it be used for the wholesale market instead or fruit market instead? Well, I think you need to look at the surrounding environment. I think this site has been zoned for residential purpose, so therefore we're building a PRH there. Next one, Tam Yu Chong. On the Tuen Mun Suhong Lo footbridge improvement works. In the paper, it shows that by 2013, the District Council's committee expressed support for the improvement works and asked to expedite the work. So why is it that only now you are telling us about the plan? In Area 54, next year, people will move into the PRH there. So, and you're only taking the first step now. We don't know whether your funding proposal request will be passed this year. So it may take 1 to 2 years before the improvement works are done. What will happen to the residents? Why has it taken so long? Didi? Thank you for your question. Because underground at the site are some utilities that need to be removed before we can build the lift tower and the escalator. So that takes time. You know, we need to build a lift and the footbridge, and we need to come to LegCo for funding for those facilities. We're following the usual procedures. But when you built the PRH, you should have designed these support facilities. You could have done all these works at the same time instead of waiting till after utilities underground are removed, then you come to apply for funding. You should have done all the work in one go at the same time, because now the residents may have to wait 1 year before they can use the footbridge. Why is there such a gap? For details, I'll ask Mr. Low to give you more information. Mr. Low. Thank you. Member, for your view. As the DD said, underground, there is a large pipe and water pipe and also cables as well, underground. And the land there, actually the space concern isn't that spacious. And underground, Suhong Road, there's also a culvert that actually crosses the entire ground surface. So really, that takes time, you know, for us to negotiate, discuss the matter with relevant departments. and also with the electricity company to discuss about the removal of so many facilities, underground facilities. There are also some limitations that we need to overcome for pipes, and so forth. Some of them span the railway tracks nearby. So it really takes time, and we have to do some studies. Once we discover a feasible work plan, we then submitted the plan to electrical, hopefully to get the work started ASAP. So for the removal works, have they all been done, or have you only just sorted out how to carry out the works concerned underground? Yes, you're right. We have now got an option and a plan in mind on the removal of the underground facilities, and that will pave the way for the construction. So the first thing we'll do is to remove the underground facilities first. Then we can lay the foundation and so forth. And the existing footbridge, we're concerned that because of its location, it may not be used by the residents. The residents may still prefer to go on the ground surface instead of opting for the footbridge. What do you think, Mr. Lo? We have considered that the footbridge will provide a routeway for people with needs. Say if they want to take an escalator or take a lift, then they can go to the West Rail station through the footbridge and the links. But if people want to go to the West Rail or Light Rail station via ground surface, then they can actually, there will be a path, narrow path to be built that will take people via ground surface to the rail stations. Next one, to three public works enhancement to category A, I have no objection in principle.
I want to follow up the one on ground decontamination works in some triple. Some members have mentioned that because of the land release problem, you have to do it in phases. You talk about metal and asbestos contamination. You have done a ground investigation. Have you covered phase one? You have not covered the Changsha One wholesale vegetable market? Or is it that the problem is confined to the phase one site? We'd like to upgrade this project to category A in two phases. For the first phase, it will cover the ex Changsha One abattoir. The second phase will cover the vegetable market. The member is correct that we carry out an investigation before demolition. So as to find out how many building structures contained asbestos, and whether there was any ground in contamination. As for the wholesale vegetable market, it's still in operation. We have not done any investigation because we need to dig up the surface, the ground surface, to do the investigation. Okay. My concern is that after you have done what you have to do for phase one, you would find some other contaminations in phase two site. of course, you have to get some expert assessment whether in the future there will be cross-contamination and the like. For the sports center at Choi Wing Road, you have a maze arena with 500 permanent seats. It's as big as two basketball courts. The seats are permanent. Well, the point is, do you need to have permanent seats? Are you expecting a lot of spectators for the two basketball courts, for example? If it's a basketball match, of course, you can expect to have that kind of spectator attendance. And are you going to make use of the rooftop of the structure, such as screening? On the top, there will be an open space for the PRH development. So yes, we are going to use the rooftop. I would like to defer to Doris of LCSD to say something about the May Games Arena and the seats. Not all the arenas have so many seats. Sometimes there are matches and tournaments. For example, schools may organize competitions there. If we have more seats, then we can encourage schools or national sports associations to make use of such arenas with seating, the necessary seating capacity. Chairman, my time is up. I would like them to give me more information on the frequency of such needs of in respect of the 500 seats there. Please give the information to members for reference in due course. Mr. Chen Kam Lam, we support the three proposed public works program items for the sports center at Choi Wing Road. It's going to be taken up together with PRH development project, giving the time arrangement in this council. And you want to get this approved within this term. Well, if it's not endorsed by the PWSC, are you going to proceed to the FC direct? Because this is linked to the PRH project. If this cannot go ahead, would it affect the PRH project as well? You have a car park. How many spaces would there be? Can the sports center users use the car park as well? Or is the car park used by PRH tenants only? For this comprehensive project, of course, we'd like to get the approval of the PWSC and the FC, because it may affect the timetable of the PRH completion. If this cannot be done within this year, then the PRH commencement will be deferred as well. As for the car park, I'll ask Mr. Ricky, my colleague Ricky, to respond. The car park is planned for the both Choi Fook Estate and the Sports Center. We have reserved two spaces for use by the disabled, and there will be two spaces for coaches. how many spaces will there be in the car park? And I'm concerned about the timing. Good luck if you can get the approval this year. If not, you have to restart in the next term of LegCo. But for the PLH project, it's been taken care of by the HA, I suppose. You can start on your... Can you start first? Or you cannot do it piece by piece? We have to grant one contract or carry out a development project together with the sports center. We cannot just do the PRH. We will supplement more information in writing later. All right, please. It's Alice Mak. As Mr. Tam Yu Chung has said, we certainly support the project at Siu Hong Road, but we are concerned about whether you can complete that in time. You want to get the approval within this term, that is by July, and it will be commissioned in 2019. But population intake would happen in 2017. There would be a gap of almost 2 years. But what can we do other than criticize you? Can you expedite the progress through other means? Because for some time, people will have to cross the road at Gray before we have the lift and the footbridge. In the 1 year or so, what kind of road design will be implemented, or what kind of road traffic management will be put in place? In many locations where we have lift towers, well, if they are convenient, then you have a long queue for people pushing their prams or using wheelchairs. Would the lifts be spacious enough with the necessary capacity to carry, say, a few wheelchairs? I'll ask my colleague, Mr. Fung, to respond. Mr. Luke, to respond. Yes, we'd like to start the project as soon as we can. But if there's any problem with the funding approval, well, we'll provide something on the ground at grade, which is convenient for pedestrians. This lift tower will house 4 passenger lifts, not commonly seen in other locations. A lift would allow 2 wheelchairs to enter. So the size is big enough for 2 wheelchair users. Well, if it's convenient, you don't need the lift tower. If it's not, that's why you need the lift tower. If you say that the crossing is at Gray and it's convenient, so what's the use of the lift tower if it's true? What kind of arrangement can you work out with the transport department in the 1 year or so gap? I'll ask my colleague to respond. Well, this footbridge is 30 meters above ground, and people have to use a staircase. It's not barrier-free. That's why we want to install lifts for the disabled. My colleague has already said that a lift car is sufficient to house two wheelchairs and also for prams. So in the transitional period, at the beginning of the project, along the side of the railway station, we will provide a pavement so that pedestrians can walk along Siu Hong Road and access Siu Hong Station. So for the period of 1 year or so, that will be the arrangement. Before you go to the FC, please tell us, of course, that there are no people using the crossing or the staircase. In the future, there will be more than 10,000 users. So what kind of measures will be implemented to make it convenient for users? Well, you say that the gray pavement is convenient, then that's already done. Well, this is done under the Universal Accessibility Program. Isn't it what Mr. C.Y. Leung has said after he assumed office? The footbridge is already there, correct? So it's under the Universal Accessibility Program advocated by C.Y. Leung. Then you are really bold. It was endorsed by the Tuen Mun District Council in 2013, and then a gazetto took place in 2015. There was a gap of 2 years. Why?
So it's nothing to do with whether there's an estate or not. Of course, now with a new estate bill, it's even more needed. But you haven't explained. You said there are not enough works and put the blame on me. Can you explain the situation to us? You said that it would be a huge problem if the request is not passed in this logical term. Well, access. Well, this is something advocated by the chief executive. But they're from the housing department. Have you asked the right question? Well, they tend to mix things together now. And because of the pending, moving into the area by 13,000 people, and they want to get the work done. But, Ms. Mak made a good point. If it's convenient at ground level, then there's no need for the lifts and so forth. Yes, people can walk, of course, on the ground. We will also carry improvement works on the ground level. But for the details, I'll ask David to comment. Thank you, Chairman. The improvement works actually comprise three parts. One is the barrier-free access that we knew about before, and the highways department will arrange for the installation of lifts to provide barrier-free access. And when we consult the district council, and there's the request for the escalator. Well, sorry, I have a point here. If, by C.Y. Leung's proposal for barrier-free access, when he made the proposal, he never expected 13,000 people would move in there. So because our concept left behind at times, and the footbridge has no lift tower, then his suggestion would have been a good policy. But Ms. Mak made a very, very accurate point. You have mixed things together, but you can't really explain to us the rationale, but I'm not dwelling on that. Now, back to the Cheung Sha Wan Abattoir. you said that there'll be a small amount of asbestos materials. How much? And you said that some soil may be contaminated. What sorts of metals are contaminating there? Can you give us the details? Because without those details, you carry out part of the work. And but part of your work may cause the heavy metals to circulate to other areas. And that could lead to unwanted consequences. Who would address that? Okay, let me give a simple reply here. The amount of asbestos, through some site investigation design, we have identified the amount. The asbestos waste materials occupy about 45 square meters, and of them, asbestos make about 5 square meters. As for the soil contaminated by heavy metal, they make up about 200, an area about 200 square meters. When we investigate the site, we have identified asbestos areas which are indoors. We have actually identified their exact locations. As for contaminated soil, we've also known where they are. They're just in some scattered locations. Can you ask them to give us the information you just mentioned? Okay, yes, they can give it to you after the meeting. Next one, Wu Chi Wai. I'd like to talk about the sports center in Kuntong. On the hillside, Choi Fook Chun, Choi Tak Chun, they have a lingering problem of, besides a food supply store, all along. I'd like to ask the housing department whether they would actually provide a market there besides the shop that sells frozen meat. Now that we're going to have the Stage 3 PRH development and you have a sports center below the podium, so why can't you incorporate the need for a market in the building under the podium so that the two estates can be served by the market? Or is it that you're going to build similar facilities to meet the residents' needs? Thank you. Just in the slide, I said that for this particular project, the Housing Authority have provided 42-store wet market on ground level. So the area will have a wet market. Yes. Yes, the wet market will be funded partly by the Housing Authority. So in other words, once the sports center is finished, in the phase 3 Choi Fook Estate, there will be a wet market with 42 wet markets besides the new PRH and the sports center. That's right. You can go back to slide number 11, then you will find the information. As for the Tu Mun Siu Hong Road, the pedestrian flow, I'll ask David to give you the further detail. Yes. In Tu Mun Area 54, Site 2, there will be 13,000 people moving in there. But our estimate of pedestrian flow, the people who will be using the rest rail station, we estimate that two-way, people using the footbridge, there will be about 3,800 people during peak hours. For the escalators, it has an alley capacity of 4,500 people. Okay, for anything that's not related to what's been asked by member, you can match them in another time slot. Any other questions? Do we need to have a second round of Q&A? If not, then we wrap up this item. Next item now then. I heard quite a lot of questions just then. Is it that we will support this Big Words program proposal to be submitted to the Finance Committee? Well, they explained that, but you were not in. Well, you were not here and one step out beforehand. Would you want them to answer your questions after the meeting? I think for PWSC, they need to submit to the committee information on what they're going to do. Yes, just then some members have asked for some supplementary information to be provided to this panel or even to the paper for PWSC. Please attach them to your papers later on, okay? So if there's no objection to this item being put to PWSC, thank you. Next item, 5. Creation of one supernumerary chief engineer post in CDD and one permanent chief estate surveyor post and one permanent chief housing manager post in housing department. Let's wait for the administration representatives to come in. So please invite them to come in. For the next item, the metal gate.
我哋咁有效率嘅同事，即係好似罰我哋咁。你啲同事未到啊，佢鬧嘢。我哋傾跌集先啦，如果係咁。So
let's talk about the following item. Oh, the officials not here yet either for that one.
叫 Ada 入嚟講啦，叫阿處長入嚟啦。阿處長喺邊度啊？叫阿 Ada 入嚟講咪得咯，佢代表曬噶啦嘛。 到啦，到啦，到晒啦！我哋好有效率噶，你下次早15分鐘冇计啊！哦，阿英生未到系嘛？我哋倾住先咯，第二个答到噶嘛，系啊，可唔可以你哋？
Can anyone take us through the paper? Okay, I'll start, Chairman. Thank you, Chairman. Ms. Wong, yes. Sorry, we didn't expect that you would start so early. I'll take you through briefly the paper. You may have read it. In this paper, we are seeking members' views on the creation of three directorate posts. The three posts are professional grades. The reason is that in promoting the long-term housing strategy, whether it's for building the housing or upon completion of a housing estate, the need for maintenance and repair, and also the subsidized sale flat scheme during the process of selling flats in the past few years, we found that the workload has increased. So we need to increase the professional staff. Therefore, we want to create a three directorate posts, D1 posts. They are in the CEDD. We want to create one supernumerary chief engineering post for 5 years. This post is needed because on many government lands, in preliminary works, often there's a need for replanning. And during the process of replanning, inevitably, we need to carry out technical feasibility studies. And CEDD itself is already overloaded. And it cannot really spare much capacity to help us. Therefore, if there's no replanning of a site, we cannot create or build housing projects there. And another post is that of a chief housing manager, a permanent post in the housing department. As I said, we've got more and more PRH estates coming on stream, so there's a need for maintenance and repair. We need someone at directorate grade to overlook the daily management work. The third post is one permanent chief estate surveyor, a permanent position. We need it because the past few years we have resumed the selling of HOS flats, and we are also selling the subsidized sell flats. We are short-staffed, therefore we need a professional surveyor to help us with the price setting and also other work related to preparation of sales brochures. We do need professional input for those work. So simply put, these are the three posts to be created. I'm open to views from members, and we are very happy to answer any questions you have. So those who raise their hands include Chen Wei-chun, Mok Ho-heng, Matt Mei-kuen, and Tammy Chung. Each will have 4 minutes, including answer. The first one, Chen Wei-chun. Of course, in view of your increased workload, you may need to hire additional staff. We do support that. On these three posts, can the administration give us a bit more information? Firstly,
the first one is a time-limited supernumerary post. It's because they need to handle infrastructure, and also some sites for housing, public housing. Of course, with a bigger and bigger public housing program, the workload of the housing department is increasing as a whole. But what about other professionals, such as architects? Nowadays, complexity of sites for PRH is much bigger than what it was. And also, the housing department has to work with the district councils concerned. And the same goes for repair and maintenance. Once you have built the housing units, and gradually you have population intake like the last one, it would happen in 2017, and you need more people for different types of work. So my question is, why is it that you only increase this supernumerary post for the pre-project duties? You have more housing units completed, and there are other duties which have increased. You have quoted some figures. So what kind of increase do we have to get before we establish a new team? Well, for the so-called pre-development duties, so we're talking about a very preliminary stage. The land itself might not be even zoned housing, may not be zoned for public housing. Mr. Chen, we have identified more sites for future housing, public housing development. We need to carry out an investment assessment on the implications, the impacts on the road network, the residents nearby, and even the drainage and the infrastructure. We need a directorate officer to lead a team to do this. Well, I'm not questioning that. Yes, if you, well, what about if you need to change the zoning? Is it that other people don't have to take do anything, and you just rely on this engineer? Sorry for coming a bit late. Well, we started early. So we have a lot of preliminary work for house public housing development projects today. We propose 3 D1 posts. That those are what we need this year. But actually, earlier we have got secure support from the Finance Committee for creating more posts. For example, for the construction division, we increased the number of posts of for architects and so on. Every year, we will review the manpower situation before we kickstart the projects for the year. This time, we want to increase this chief engineer post in CDD, and then in a moment, we'll be talking about manpower for housing estate management and the sale of HOS. My time is already up. Of course, my colleague can say something about those areas. Better not. Let's have Mr. Wong Kok Heng. I'll give you more some time to elaborate your case. Let's say if this council doesn't approve the three posts, what would happen? Why are they necessary? Well, I will be providing an overall response. I'll leave the details to my colleagues. For the relevant duties concerned related to the three posts, our colleagues have been doing that. So as far as possible, our colleagues would absorb additional workload and duties. But we have to recognize that if the workload keeps increasing and our colleagues would have to absorb the additional workload, they may not be able to do it as quickly as we like, or they may not be doing as good a job. For example, the CDD, the chief engineer, well, has been doing the assessment for PLH size along with other duties, but their capacity to do this will be limited, although they would still do their best. And we have not increased our directorate manpower, and over the years we are going to have more and more public housing estates commissioned. Our colleagues will certainly do their best to cope, but then they will not be able to do a job, or the speed of handling issues will be affected. And also for the sale of HOS, for a long period we did not sell any HOS, Fred. When the scheme was resumed, we absorbed the workload by other colleagues, and now we're doing a lot more. We have a green former scheme. We're selling HOS fresh. So if with the additional posts, we'll be able to make decisions quicker. We'll be doing a better job overall. Permanent secretary, you want to create three posts. They have to do with building PLH, managing the your buildings, and then selling HOS. I think you should tell members directly. Yes, in no uncertain terms. It's about building, managing, and selling your units. We Such a directory post are created only after close scrutiny by the government, and we can't do without them. What would happen if you don't have these new posts? I think you will support the creation of the post. So I'm asking you for the adverse implications, the difficulties that would have caused to you. Chairman, you are right in supplementing the question. In the CEDD, they are doing a professional job. When the government identifies a site and we have to carry out the technical study before we can decide whether it can be used for PLH, and if necessary, what other supplementary infrastructure is required. If we don't have this post, the speed of identification of PRH site will be slower. On housing management, we have six regions, each headed by a chief housing manager. If we don't have a new post, then they will have to take care of more and more public housing estates and all the issues and problems of faced by the tenants. So without a new post, the time required to tackle problems would be longer. On the sale of HOS, if we don't have this D1 post, our colleagues will continue to take care of all the policy issues and the actual sale of HOS and green farmers purchase of HOS. Well, they will have to make the decisions in a longer time frame. And some of the monitoring and regulation will be more lax. We're seeing so many PRH units completed, and the resumption of the sale of new HOS flats are going in full steam. So the workload has increased for the HD staff. So we understand that. You're now creating three directory posts. What about the frontline staff? They are all facing a very difficult situation. So are you going to increase manpower of lower ranks? We want more size for PLH. But how much quicker can we get a size for PLH if we have this new D1 post in the CEDD? To what extent can this new engineer post help us achieve our target under the LHTS or LTHS? And with one more chief housing manager, well, we can handle the problems in the estates better. I support the creation of this post. But what about other management staff in the estates? And also the demarcation of the districts or regions is a bit odd to me. How do you delineate different regions? Well, these three are directory posts, because we need your agreement before we can create them. For this year, we're going to create 193 non-directory posts in the housing department in different sections. In the CEDD, I believe you can see from the paper, apart from this D1 post, there will be 19 additional non-directory posts. So to respond to Mr. Alice Mack's questions, we are going to increase manpower, and not just these three directory posts. You are concerned about the new D1 post in the CEDD and to what extent it would help us achieve our long-term housing strategy. Well, certainly, with one more D1 post, it's going to help in the process of identifying sites for PLH projects, but I cannot say that with this additional post, it will be plain sailing for us. Whereas I have said again and again, the important thing is the supply of sites. So the Development Bureau and other departments must offer timely support, and we need to get the rezoning approved by the Town Planning Board as well. I thank members for showing appreciation of the workload pressure faced by housing management staff. Well, with more and more public rental housing estates completed, for each chief housing manager, ideally, should take care of 100,000 to 120,000 PLH units. And as the permanent secretary has said, for more than 10 years, we have created no new chief housing manager post. We have one chief housing manager managing 150,000 from North District, Sai Kung. Each chief housing manager is managing 145,000 units. So with this new post, we can share the additional workload so that we can bring the level back to a better ideal level. So that's why for Xiangsui, we want to even out the number of units put under each CHM. And that's why we have this demarcation mark along Wontai Xin and Qingyi. And we are not trying to increase posts at the senior level only at the expense of lower ranks. Actually, over the years, we have seen a small increase every year of non-directorate posts. And we will also look at deployment. The new D1 post, chief housing manager post, will be supported by 680 subordinates. And you can look at it from the other way, that we have this additional post. So only after 680 posts have been created. I'm not in support of outsourcing more job to contractors.
Tam Yu Chung next. Over the past few years, home ownership scheme construction has stopped and the supply of PRH units have been decreased, and now you expedite the construction and you want to create a director post for management purpose. I think that's understandable. But whenever we create a senior post, we need to be very careful to be sure that there is really a need for it. That's why so many questions have been asked. I do hope that through the new posts, the supply and construction of PRH estates can be expedited and management work can also be enhanced. For the estate surveyor post, you know, to help with the price setting of HOS flats, I hope that the work will be done well. Otherwise, you know, if the price set is too different from the market trends, then should the market have any change, then people would, like what happened recently, people would hesitate about purchasing HOS flats. So you need to think of ways. We can increase your manpower, you know, create the director post, but you need to make sure that you can improve the situation. Mr. Ying, yes, I think the price setting, as mentioned by Mr. Tam, the chairman of the Subsidized Housing Committee under the HA, did brief the media recently. Whenever the Housing Authority launches new flats, the authority would set the price and also based on the latest sale exercise, we'll try to gather the experience and see how we can do an even better job in price setting. If we have a new colleague, so in the long run, for similar work, he will be able to help support our work. Next one, Wu Chi-wai. Thank you, Chairman. Firstly, about the engineer post, to implement infrastructure projects supporting public housing departments, I think it's appropriate to have the CE post. But for the development bureau, but besides 70 sites, is it that it has still lots of land in hand that can afford the future expansion plan? Because if you can have the newly added posts to make use of the lands available, then that would be good. And for the other two posts, I have some views. Firstly, about the CES, as mentioned in the paper, he will be mainly responsible for the sale of HOS flats and planning for the sale exercises of other flats under the HK, Hong Kong HA. But say, for example, you may find it mind-boggling, all sorts of arrangements made for these exercises. But once you've done it the first time, the procedures could be repeated afterwards. So why is it that in the past, the post concern can be handled by staff under the deputy director, and now you have to create a new post? I think that maybe you need someone to do it, to do the job in the beginning stage. So would it be possible to turn this into a supernumerary post instead? Because once the preliminary work has been kickstarted, you can review whether there's a need really for a permanent position. As for the management post, I'd like to ask the PS to explain this to us. When it comes to management, if I only decide what sorts of work has to be done based on the size of an estate, that's not very scientific. You can all understand that in the coming 10 years, under our housing development plan, there will be a number of new units in the years ahead. Obviously, management-wise, the newly built units, they will have fewer management problems than the old style PRH estates. So should we still adopt the previous approach, that is to have a chief manager managing a population of 100,000 to 120,000? Should we stick to the old system? I do hope that the PS can really evaluate the current arrangement. Another point is, remember when I first became a member, the chief manager of the housing department has a lot of power. He can make all sorts of decisions. But the chief manager now has to report to the assistant director before he can make a decision on the front line. So the powers given to chief managers, duties assigned to chief managers, what are they? Or is he just sort of a coordinating person? I think this is something that is worth PS looking into. We should not just inherit the same old system of having a manager for that particular fixed number of residents. Any response? Chairman, I will say a few words and then ask my colleague to supplement. Agnes could give you more details on the CES post. For the CHM post, we were discussing on a district basis. I think Albert gave you the figures, but figures are just one of the consideration factors. I understand, Mr. Wu, your point. We will not just abide by a numerical method in deciding whether there's a need for an extra post. Over the past 10 years or so, we have tried to use existing manpower to absorb additional needs. As explained in the paper, it's not just about quantity, it's also about quality. Your first question about the CE in the CEDD, my understanding is that within the government, if you want to find a piece of land for building a public housing by HA, there's a lot of advanced work that needs to be done. For this D1 post, He needs to carry out the technical feasibility study and other technical studies. And even before that, there needs to be effort made to find the land and to see whether the land concern should be handed over to the housing authority. In the coming decade, you'll know that we aim to build 280,000 PRH units. And so far, we haven't found enough land to meet that target. So identifying land and carrying out feasibility study, that is something that needs to be continued. Chairman, can my colleague supplement? Agnes first, please. Thank you, Chairman. In response to Mr. Wu's question on the CES for new projects, for example, like the latest sale exercise, every time there's a sale going on, whether it's for the HOS or subsidized sale flats, every time the HA needs to redefine the prices of the flats. So each time there needs to be a new sales brochure to be printed. Who will be eligible? And also after first-hand sales, every time we are giving out information, we need to be accurate, and we also need to comply with certain requirements. The assistant director currently, besides looking at subsidized sale flats, he's also responsible for PRH units. So just for subsidized sales flats alone, there are 6 units under him already who report directly to him. And when it comes to price setting, he does need the input of professional surveyors. Therefore, he alone, just looking at PRH units, he counts on the reports of 6 teams. And he's not an expert in the area himself. So now with more HOS and other subsidized sale flats coming onto the market, to have a professional staff at D1 level to help with the interactive work, will help smooth out the process. And we'll also look after all details as well with the additional post. Next one, please. Yes, as for the number of units to be provided onto the market, that's not just our sole factor, but that's an important factor to consider, because with more units being made available, then that will of course directly affect our workload. And also with the new policy and the implementation, we need to see whether we can achieve the same level of management, property management, and rental as well, so that we can make sure that things will go smoothly in all districts. And that's the reason why we want to create this additional post of CHM. It also includes, for example, security services, cleanliness, and recycling, and also rental management. We do hope that this new post can play a monitoring role and help formulate guidelines. Thank you. Liang Yuchong. Last week, in Kuaichun District Council, we discussed the Liking and old school premises there, and they plan to build a new PRH estate there. And we discussed issues, for example, light pollution, and the housing development staff that they had not considered, and neither were they aware of the problem of light pollution in the area. But Chairman, having been a district councillor for 30 years, every year, not even every year, but maybe most of the time, Liking, we've said many times that is subject to light pollution from the container terminal. And yet, the housing department staff, when they design the estate, they had not paid attention to the issue. In paragraph 8 of the paper, you said that you would maintain close ties and communications with district councils. Is it because there's no there isn't an additional post, that's why you had not kept close ties with district council? Is it why your colleague didn't know about the issue of light pollution? Please consider that. And I found it strange that, you know, the paper before it says that you want to have this additional post to formulate policies and to maintain communications with district council. In the past, was it because you didn't have the manpower, that's why you never had enough communication? And Also, you said in some green areas or in some area previously zoned for GCI purpose, you would look and find whether there are any candidates for residential sites. So if that's the case, then how about your original plan and consultation? If there is to be deviations from your previous concepts, then that would have much implications for the community, because for green belts or GCI sites, you know, how can you strike a balance between community needs and your effort to find land? On your second question, I think that is very specialized. Maybe I'll ask a colleague from CDD to answer that. But as for the liking area, I'm not aware about your point about light pollution. I mean, who answered that? Is it someone from the housing department? Yeah. Well, back to today's paper. My understanding is that in this D1 post in CDD, this will be a post to carry out study on whether land chosen should be used for PRH units. But I think, Mr. Leung, your point is about the design of PRH estates, whether they have accommodated the issue of light pollution. If that's what you're talking about, then that's under the housing department. Chairman, I was saying that in the paper, you said you would maintain a substantial engagement with district councils, as mentioned in paragraph 8. But whether, like, given the example I just told you, I know that you want someone to identify land for residential development.
The housing department has to communicate with many departments. I don't think it's only the housing department that would make the decision on public housing. So my point is it because you don't have this new post, you have not been able to maintain liaison with district council? Or you want to talk about communication between the CEDD and the district council? I'll have to turn to my colleague. Is it Mr. Chan? Thank you, Mr. Leung. I can assure Mr. Leung on behalf of CEDD one thing. Well, I know that Mr. Leung has been in communication with CEDD for a long time. We have been implementing the Universal Accessibility Program in the district. And secondly, for the Queens Hill project, we have briefed the North District Council, and we have invited the council to offer comments. I would like to give some background information to Mr. Leung concerning this supernumerary D1 post. In the past few years, the CEDD has been deploying the directorate manpower to assist with the public housing programs. We have 24 NCSC's posts created, but no directorate. Staff. We're going to have 5 new engineering team with 25 posts. We need to have this new directorate post, otherwise we are going to have a problem of too big a controlling span. You are saying that you want to convert a non-residential sites such as green belt sites for housing purposes. So it's important to maintain the close communication with the districts. Otherwise, how can you balance different needs of the district? But you should not just convert every site into housing sites. If the district wants to have a community hall, but you say no, it must be for housing, then how can you say that you are addressing the different needs in a balanced way? Are you going to have the new post and you do everything you can to convince the districts to go with you, to go along with your suggestion? Well, the CDD will look at a site, select a site to see if it can be used for public rental housing. We'll look at the constraints, the potential, the opportunities associated with the site. Of course, when we listen to the district council and the local people, we'll try to understand the concerns of the district. The concern might be social welfare, housing, or medical, or the lack of facilities. Then we would consider whether in the new development certain elements can be incorporated to address such community needs. And so we'll come up with a proposal after the interaction. As for the best value of the purpose to be put to a site, then as a technical people, we can only do the feasibility. So perhaps you have to tell us more about the importance of changing factors. Mr. Kuo Wai Kang. The housing department proposes to create 3 additional directory posts. The workload for the department is increasing. You have 1 additional post for site identification, 1 for housing management, and 1 for sale of HOS. So it shows that the housing department is determined to do something for the long term, because these posts will be required in the long term. For the first one, the supernumerary chief engineer post in the CEDD, the post holder will have to assess the 17 selected sites for public housing. So by 2023, the land use of the sites will be ascertained? So why 5 years? And what about the sites for public housing beyond the 5-year time frame? Are all these 17 potential sites for developing new PLH? Would there be some for redevelopment purposes? If some are for redevelopment, which one of them? We have been talking about the redevelopment of Wafu Estate for some 3 years, and now we have selected 5 sites. 20-odd PLH are still waiting. They are concerned about whether sites will be available in their vicinity and whether they can be used for supporting redevelopment. So can we have more information about the 17 potential sites? I will say something and then I'll ask Mr. Chen of CEDD to supplement. The first question is why the supernumerary post will be created for five years, and also there are questions on site identified for PLH. other government departments, for example, the Development Bureau, the Planning Department will have to do a lot of work before a site can be selected for potential PRH. And at that stage, this new D1 post in CEDD will assess whether it's suitable for PRH. We have a 10-year plan for PRH development program. So far, we have been able to provide 250,000 under the program. The problem, there are still some other problems resolved after the D1 post is created. If a site is assessed to be suitable for PRH by this D1 post and other colleagues, provided that other supporting measures will be required. And it would be a separate question as to whether the site should be for a new PRH or for supporting a redevelopment of project of existing PRH. Under our long-term housing strategy, there's a chapter on when to do redevelopment. And we have already said, we have already just stated that we cannot support a comprehensive redevelopment at this stage, given the housing supply. Well, CEDD has been providing support for PRH development in site selection. We have been using our own resources in offering the support. And now we have 17 new potential sites identified. In past years, the CEDD did the feasibility assessment for 45 sites. With the increased workload, we have to consider the number of directory posts. The member asked why it's for 5 years. It's about the resources we need. If the council agrees with the creation of a new post, then we can cope with the workload. Of course, annually we will be reviewing our manpower and resource situation in the department. Mr. Lee Chuck Yan, we're concerned about increasing the senior posts at the expense of junior staff. So the concern is whether we are going to have more junior posts as well, because you attach importance to the housing management division and estate surveying division. I have a question about housing management. You're not going to sell more shopping centers to the link, right? Now there are problems. Even if you don't sell any more of your shopping centers to the link, for example, Hang Fuk Estate, the business volume is low, and you outsource the management to another company. We strongly demand that you stop outsourcing management, or else you have to monitor the rent. If you outsource the management and you decide to rent, I'll accept it. You should not allow the management company to charge whatever rent it wants. So now you are so happy with this new post in the housing management program, and this and the tenants will suffer. So can you confirm that you are not going to sell any more of your assets to the link, and also you are not going to outsource the management of your markets to an outside party? I'll ask Albert to supplement on the rental policy of a non-residential assets. And this is a question about non-direct repos. Under this year's budget, the Housing Department would create 193 additional non-direct repos. We'll create these posts throughout the own system, and for the CEDD, they have created 19 non-directorate posts. 15 of them will be working under this new D1 post for the studies of potential housing sites. I think there was a previous question put to the secretary that we have no plan to sell our commercial properties after the 2005 exercise. Albert, I can assure members that we are not going to increase senior posts and at the expense of the junior posts. So let's take this chief housing manager post as an example. With an additional regional office, we can cope with the increasing posts, and over the years, there are non-directorate posts created, and we have been using services provided by body shops. For this new region, with the new chief housing manager, he will have to oversee 600 people. And you can look at it from the other way, that we have created 600 junior posts before we ask you to create this new senior D1 post, because we may be able to outsource the management work, but the responsibility cannot be the outsourced. We need to have experienced director officers to provide the necessary steered and oversight in terms of policy, so as to make us accountable. And on this outsourcing of commercial centers and markets, for over 10 years, we have never asked for the creation of any new CHM posts. Well, use other means if the new workload can be solved through measures such as redeployment. We will not just because of a new housing estates commission, and we come here to ask for new posts to be created. Our markets and shopping centers are managed through the outsourcing. The principle is a prudent commercial principles, but you allow them to impose the rent as they wish.
We actually invited tenders. It's not that we offer it to the highest bidders. We also look at the operator's experience and past records, scores for management and so forth. It has a ratio of 50-50 ratio in assessment. Once we've awarded the tender, we also make it a requirement that should the operator sublet the site, besides basic rates payments or rentals, the operator should not impose other charges on the sublet tenants, and say for the rates to be given to the rates concerned, there are also provisions on them. But you said besides rents and rates, there should not be additional charges. But you have not imposed any control on the rents. I have a complaint about the Lucky Estate. Well, we do manage the commercial premises with commercial principles. Can we add an item in the future? We must discuss that. the HA's so-called commercial principles that we just sacrifice livelihoods. The situation is even worse than that under the link. Okay, just write it in. First round, any more questions? If not, then second round. Wu Qiwei, 4 minutes. Just then, I heard from the PS response on the engineer post, since it's a supernumerary post. I don't have much views on that, but I hope that by the time the request is submitted to the establishment subcommittee, you can provide information on particularly the gaps in PRH estates. Have you, now that the Development Bureau has found ways to plug the loophole so that the engineer post can really help expedite the supply of PRH estates? And secondly, as for CHM, I know that he will have increased workload. So on the whole, I will accept your explanation for this post. But as for the CES post, the workload related to that, I don't really see why it should be made a permanent position. So, PS, would you agree that when you submit the request to the special committee, you would change the CES to a supernumerary post instead of a permanent one, so that we can assess in the future whether there's really justification for a permanent position? And also, in the paper on the three posts, can we have actually three separate papers on them instead of one? P.S. on the supernumerary post, when we envisaged the positions, we thought that this year we do need the directorate post this year, and also focusing on Mr. Wu's question for the CES, is necessity. Why do we think that it should be a permanent one? Because it's work looking ahead. I can't really say for sure when. You know, unlike, say, technical studies jobs where there's a batch of work to be finished in a period of time. But as I and Alex tried to explain, this person's work will continue for an indefinite period. As for whether it should be made a chief CES post, look at NSJ. Just then, Agnes made a point. You can look at the structure now. Right now, there are six teams under Land Administration section, which comprises professional surveyors. The work that they're doing, I can give you the detail on what they do now, but they actually report directly to a D2 officer, which is an assistant director. So if you don't have a professional D1 grade staff overlooking the work of the teams, then in terms of management and to ensure consistency, that would not be very useful. We do need the oversight, because there's work to be continued and worked on. For example, in assessment and price setting, every time when we sell flats, our colleagues will need to assess the price. Well, please note that you don't sell HOS flats all year round. There may be only three or four times a year when they're sold. In the past few years, we haven't had a chief estate surveyor responsible for the sale exercises. So you are talking about that you will provide the resale of new flats. In paragraph 29 alone, it cannot convince me of the need to add this post of CES. Because of time, we only have 4 minutes. Maybe when we submit this request to the establishment subcommittee, we can give more details on the work, on the CES. It's not that we want the person involved to come up with new ideas, but one year, throughout the year, when there's a one or two sale exercises, there's still work to be done. When we sell flats, we need to make the provisions very clear in the land leases. But you have another surveyor doing that kind of job, right? Let me supplement. Every time when there's a sale exercise, not just for HOS flats or others, there are many others. That is for price assessment, you understand what I'm talking about, in the sales brochures and the sales documents, there's a lot of coordinating work besides the mortgage portions or the land lease or the eligibility, because once there are because of the provisions, the regulations on sale of first hand flats, we have to there's a lot of compliance that we need to do. And all the applications for mortgages and also post-sales matters is the team of experts who is responsible. That's why I said that the six teams in the current establishment who is responsible or accountable to a assistant director who also has to look at the provision of public rental housing units. It's very difficult to sustain the work with the current organization. We have stopped the HOS flat sales for some time. In the past, when the HOS flats were sold in the market, the structure was different. So our manpower, our staffing in the past have tried to absorb the work needed. But now we're talking about continuous work ahead. Looking to the future, we think that we need to have a professional staff overlooking and coordinating this particular area of work. Mr. Wu, would you accept the explanation? I don't accept it, but I don't think HOS flats is something new, but we'll put your new views on record. And by the time this request goes to the establishment subcommittee, I think they will give us more details. Next one, Chen Weiqin, follow up on my first question. I support, you know, because of the additional workload, the creation of these posts. But I also want to clarify one thing. Now, the supernumerary post is needed because of the 10 also sites which require infrastructure works. So I need to get additional information, because if you want to increase housing supply, you would need to increase the workload of various grades of staff. So can you provide us with information like over the past 3 years, because the housing, the long-term housing strategy was launched in 2014, but before that, lots of work had been done to fit in with the demand or the needs that came from this long-term strategy. In the paper, there's also the mentioning of for the CHM. One reference data is how many units a manager was responsible for. But there are differences between old and new units, and there's also now the requirement for mandatory window inspection scheme and so forth. I'd like to know, what did you consider? You know, whether you have more headcount for a region or what? I want to understand about what did you consider, you know, in deciding the need for manpower besides the number of units concerned. I'm sure over some time you will review the workload anyway. So two aspects here. P.S. I and Albert did mention already, besides the number of units, in terms of the content, work content like environmental protection or lease management, the workload in those areas have increased, and we also want to enhance our work further. So maybe I'll ask Albert whether he can supplement. Mr. Lee? Now, let me say this again. Maybe, Mr. Che, you weren't here when I covered this. In terms of units, yeah, you're right. We made reference to the number of units, but that's not the sole factor that we consider. So let me tell you why we think that the workload is excessive now. It's too excessive. For more than a decade, we have not created the post of CHM. Region-wise, We have 6 management regions. In this fiscal year, before the end of this fiscal year, overlooking close to 800,000 PRH units. So I can really give you the breakdown on the needs between old and new units, which means that each would need to shoulder 135,000 units. In the past, we found that 100,000 to 120,000 would be the appropriate size, affordable size for a management region, you know, under a manager. That would be the optimum size. But in the past few years, each year there have been new PRH units built, and now everyone has to be responsible for 135,000 units. So that's really beyond the affordability. There are particular regions that are particularly under stress. For example, in West Kowloon and Hong Kong, the chief manager is overlooking 156,000 units. In East Kowloon, it's close to 150,000 units. In Taipo North District and Sha Tin Cycle, we're talking about 145,000 units. Looking ahead, Chairman, I understand. And you may have covered that earlier because I had to attend another panel. I understand that the workload has increased and there are differences between districts. I know work pressure is heavy across districts. So with the additional posts, that's what I'm trying to get at. So yeah, that's what I was trying to explain. The three regions with heavy pressure, from if we add an additional manager, then he cannot just look at the situation in Outlying Islands and Hong Kong Island. He can also share the workload of regions, particularly the three serious regions where the workload has been actually overly excessive. And then besides data, the chief manager, in the future, we do hope that he can carry out supervision duties so that he can only not just monitor units, but also make sure that the service quality can be consistent across districts and there can be more codes of conduct to be formulated. One of his main duties is to tackle abuse use of public rental housing units.
I know I have exceeded the time. I would like to know, apart from the post for chief engineer, there are other posts created in support of the public housing developments. We would prepare the information for members' information. And also for the chief housing manager's workload, and what improvement can be made with the new posts created. For those who are with excessive workloads, who have their burden lessened, so please provide the information to members so that they can support your proposal. All right, further questions in the second round? Well, then I think I have a question. This chief estate surveyor post is for commercial properties. But the link has not been able to provide services previously provided by you. Many members would like the housing department to identify suitable premises in your housing estate so that you can allow shops selling the goods that are needed by your tenants. Would the CES be asked to look into such a possibility? Director, on the question of providing shopping facilities in our public housing estates, there was a discussion last month I understand members would like to have a full discussion again next month, where I will take up the matters with members on that occasion. This new chief estate surveyor will be doing the duties as set out in the papers, such as the sale of the new HOS flats. He will not be responsible for doing what the chairman has proposed. Well, I'm just saying is it possible to ask him to do this additionally? We want something to be done to meet the needs of tenants for the shopping. The link is not doing its job. Well, we can have a discussion later in the recent special FC meetings. We've also received questions of this nature. We will be looking into all kinds of non-residential needs, non-residential facilities such as welfare facilities, wet markets and different kinds of market. In older estates, we will try to provide the services and facilities needed. In new estates, we will also provide the needed facilities. Time is limited. I won't go into the details. In our deployment, in our staffing structure, we'll look at the shopping needs. There's another group on housing development under my colleague Miss Ada Fung. So if in a particular estate there's a need for a wet market and we can do it, we'll do it. For existing estates, they are all completed some time ago. Can we still provide, on top of the open space for the young people and the elderly, premises for shops or wet market? That's the job to be done by Albert. But we don't have a lot of space in existing estates. For this new CES post, the post holder will be mainly responsible for the sale of HOS. Further comments? And I think members don't object putting the item to the ESC for scrutiny. So I think that's all for this item. We can now move on to the next item. The next item is security issues relating to metal case of public rental housing units. Please invite the relevant officials to join us.
我哋再次歡迎Ada同埋同事。
Once again, I would like to welcome Ada and her colleagues. Ada or your colleague, please introduce the paper. Thank you. This paper briefs members on the background relating to metal gate set in public rental housing and the recent concern expressed on our Tin Shui Wai housing estates. We aim to provide effective security facilities. And there are three lines of defense. The first one is the entrance lobby and the stairway, which are protected by gates and locks. And we provide around-the-clock security services, and security guards will be stationed at the posts on the ground floor and monitor the CCTV and the intercom system. That's the main defense. The second defense is the metal gates, and the third defense is the main entrance door. The doors and locks are of different combinations. The metal gates is not designed as the main defense facility. The main door should be kept locked. Thieves cannot evade detection and go through the three lines of defense easily. There's no evidence to show that either one of the three defense devices have led to the burglaries. In some recent burglary cases in Tin Shui Wai, the affected units have no sign of breaking in, and the culprit might have used smart keys. And some tenants have claimed that they can use their metal gate key to open other metal gates. After investigations, we found out that it may be due to wear and tear resulting from long use. We have replaced the relevant locks and keys. It's important that tenants are aware of the necessary measures to be taken. For example, they should lock their doors and gates when they leave, and they should not store their keys in any publicly accessible place, and they should not label the key with their unit number. And if they have doubts about their unit security, they should report the case. Well, we'll continue to listen to the views of EMAC in enhancing our security facility. We will work with the police force in publicizing anti-crime messages. For example, the Crime Prevention Bureau of the police have advised that they should not left the main door open with the metal gates locked, because culprits can then easily observe what's going on inside the unit. My colleagues and I are happy to take questions. Mr. Leung Chi Cheung, Mr. Kuo Wai Kung. Mr. Leung Chi Cheung first. On the security issues related to metal gates. Well, according to Ms. Fong, there are three lines of defense, and therefore problems may not be related to metal gates. It seems that you have played down the importance of metal gates. I think tenants would not agree with you. They think that the safest device that they have got is the metal gate. And then if you say additionally, you have the security post. Well, this is not what the tenants think. And paragraph 4 is especially the laughable. It said that after your investigation, the relevant logs have been affected by long use and wear and tear, and then you have replaced the relevant logs and upon the receiving reports. The answer is tantamount to the not offering an answer. Of course, you have to replace worn-out logs. The problem is that if you use your own key and randomly you try to open other gates, and you can do it, and it can be done easily. You can easily pick a gate and open the lock. So if this can be done easily and you have thousands of units, it means that you have only got a limited number of keys, only a few types or dozens of types or different types of keys are used in an estate. So tenants are worried. So you can assure them by, say, replacing the gates. Well, yes, it's costly, I agree. Can you install an additional lock or handle or bar? You don't know whether it's feasible. So the offer solution is that I'll replace the lock if you find if you find problems with your lock. I've received complaints from teen youth estate tenants that they can open the lock with bare hands. So you should conduct a comprehensive study so as to assure people. And now we have a new problem that locks can easily be opened with just your hands. Because housing estates were completed in different periods, and they have and the locks and keys come in different designs, and sometimes the gate was replaced after different tenants have moved in. I think I can ask Mr. Stephen Wong to supplement on housing management. We understand the concern, and we of course share the concerns expressed by our tenants. As for Teen Chak and Teen You, we'll talk to the district councillors concerned. If the lock is not working, we'll replace it. We stress that there are three lines of defense in our housing estates. The security guard will step up a patrol and monitoring of the housing estate.
We also provide public education, reminding residents to lock their windows and doors, and not to put the addresses on the keys or put the keys under the carpets and so forth, so as to reduce crimes. As for Teen U estate, if there are individual units that could actually open locks with their hands, then we'll see what can be done about that. Basically, for the metal gates in the estates, it'll be quite difficult for people to just use their hands to open the lock. I'm talking about second generation metal gates. I can show you a picture. I don't think it should be quite difficult for people to just open locks with bare hands. But we'll follow up on the case you mentioned. Any other questions? Next one. Kok Wai Kwan, as for security in PRH estates, as for burglaries in Tin Shui Wai, of course, we're concerned about households there. I personally, in the private building, even if you have security guards there, gates, doors, there are still burglaries. But of course, the burglars would go for the easy way out. So any anti-theft and security devices are very much needed. As for the metal gate issues, I often go to Wafu Estate. Many of the gates are very old. Sometimes their locks are also broken. I believe that some of the residents there, because they cannot move the or open or move the metal gate, they just leave it unlocked altogether. If the weather isn't good and if an elderly resident feels stuffy, then they may want to leave the door open and just rely on the gate for security. And now that the housing department says that they have a gate replacement scheme to replace the gates with some shelters, the scheme launched in 15-16 will be carry out over a five-year period to help 170,000 units replace their gates. So I'd like to find out about the progress of the scheme so far. And how many contractors are involved in the scheme? And how many lock producers there are in that are involved? Do you have that many types of locks? A variety of keys that would be needed, because if we don't have enough variety, then it could happen that, you know, if some locks are similar, then one key could be used to open several units. How can you ease public worries in that regard? I'll ask Mr. Stephen Wong to talk about the metal gate replacement scheme, and then Mr. Yim can talk about the locks. Thank you, Mr. Kwok, for your question. I think you're very clear that as states which are more than 30 years old, we have a scheme to replace the gates there over a five-year period. That is a run from 2015-16 to 2019-20. We've got several suppliers for the gates. For elderly tenants or disabled people, they will be given priority. For some individual needy people, we will give them priority for the gate replacement. So we have talked to the mutual aid committee or district councils there to see who should be given priority. Mr. Yim, as for the locks, whether actually the locks could actually be easily opened. All the design of the locks for doors and gates, metal gates, the chances are very slim when actually there will be similar locks and that can be opened easily. In cases of burglaries, of course, the burglars will go for the easy locks. Rather than using the same key to try open various locks, sometimes the burglars will just use smart keys or just cheat the household tenants to open the door, to get them to open the door for them. But for the manufacturers concerned, actually they produce the locks in a computerized way. In the production method process, they carry out send them random checks on the locks so that actually the monitoring staff under our department will also carry out random checks on the locks. But just then Mr. Lai said that there could be various combinations for a lock, but there are altogether now 2,000 combinations now for locks. But based on our experience so far, as explained in the paper, the chances of someone using the same key to open the lock on the door and the metal key are very, very minimal. So there are 2,000 types. So of the 770,000 units, there are chances of, same combinations, but no thief would try to use one key to try various locks, one after another. But what are the chances of similar combinations for lock? But just then, as I said, there are 2,000 combinations with computerization. There are actually more than 20, could go up to 6,000. You all know that technology has kept upgrading and the lock design has become more precise. But it will, in other words, make it harder and harder for people to unlock a gate or door. Any questions for the first round? If not, then second round, Lan Chi-cheng. 4 minutes. I'd like to ask the housing department to answer this. I've noticed the design of the gates and the types of them. Sometimes there is this sort of style, the folding style. Just then you said there are 2,000 combinations. But is it that for the 2,000 combinations, they are not concentrated in one estate? The 2,000 combinations, two of them, 200 or 300, will be used for one single estate. Mr. Wong may be clear. And then other hundreds of combinations may be for other estates. That means, of course, the chances of having two units having the same combination may be slim. But still, people are worried. I've mentioned this to Mr. Wong. Maybe next to the metal gate, could you add another lock? So that it would become 20,000 combinations instead. And that means the chances of opening the lock by a stranger will be even slimmer. There's room to put another lock next to it, right? On the same gate. In Tin Shui Estate, they don't use the folding gate, but they use even an earlier generation folding gate. But later on, they inserted a plug, some sort of plug to a lock to enhance safety. Is that possible? I'll ask Mr. Wong to answer this. That is the situation in present estates. I think each gate has its own characteristics. We would not recommend adding more locks to a gate because it happened before. There's an incident that in case of a fire, if someone cannot get the key, then there's a chance of danger there. So the gate itself, as Mr. Im said, there are all sorts of combinations for locks. So the chances of finding the same combination on two households are very high. Well, it can happen. But it just so happens that the thief or someone finds the same combinations. If that's the case, then we could change the lock. The chances of having the same combinations for two locks are very low anyway. So we want to tackle the problem at its root. That's why would someone use marquee to open a gate? If we have enhanced security, then that would be a solution, a better solution. Have you increased manpower? We have increased the number of patrols around the estates and during peak hours. Our security guards will not be sitting still, but he will have to stand up to keep an eye on people going in and out. And we've also minimized the replacement of security guards so that each guard will be more familiar with the people living in an estate. And for the metal gates, for those who have wear and tear, if we have received any complaints or concerns, we will carry out inspections on the gates, and we found that the problem with the locks will replace them immediately. Next one, Kwok Wei Kang. As for the metal gates and replacement, replacing gates and in old estates, of course, that should be done as soon as possible. Of course, you need to do some first and leaving the others to be replaced later on. Just as you said, the weak and old disabled will have priority. I'm glad to hear that. Yet the problem is, even for those who are not in that category, the people who worry about security, if that person unfortunately is at the bottom of the priority list, then that person would be very scared, you know, worry about being robbed. So has the department thought about, for some households or tenants, if they are willing to find somebody to replace the gate? Of course, we talk about qualified contractors to do the replacement. Would you consider subsidizing units to find private contractors to change the gate? Of course, the cost cannot be too high, and it should be set at a level acceptable to the housing department. Would you accept that? Mr. Wong, please. Basically, we like to do it in a unified way to ensure standards are met, and also to ensure the same style of gate is put there. If people do it individually, then there could be differences. Based on our past experience, a housing department has its own set of criteria and standards. If there are any changes to be made, approvals would need to be sought. If they want to change the standard or style, we definitely don't have the plan to allow that. But for individual tenants, or if there are district councillors who feel that, you know, some tenants, because of some special reasons, want to have the gate replaced earlier, we will consider that. We can try to help them.
Well, thank you. But you are not able to address the problem with the waiting time. It would be a wait of 5 years. They should be allowed to get a contractor. Of course, they must only install a metal gate of the specified design. And that cannot be considered? Well, we'll have to be responsible for future repair and maintenance. This must be, we think this is better if it's the installation is done under proper supervision. And we have prioritized the timetable. By this, we will take into account many factors, including the tenant's needs. We give priority to elderly tenants because older gates are very heavy. So we would provide new ones to them first. And we do not encourage tenants to deal with this problem themselves. Then I would urge the department to expeditiously complete the 5-year program. Actually, it has already commenced. It's ongoing for housing estates requiring gate replacements. We have started in 1998. 4 will commence in 2016-2017. The preparation is being done. Mr. Frederick Fung, I know that work has commenced in Lai Kok Estate. You are replacing the first generation gate with the third generation ones. I missed some of the conversations. If a key can open a number of gates, there may be a law and order problem. It's just like a mailbox. It's been found that a mailbox key can open a few mailboxes in the same building. There are only 2,000 key combinations. Is that the case? Have you said that there is a probability of 1 to 2,000 something? First, Mr. Leung said it was 2,000. And I have already said that because of improvement in technology, it's now more than 6,000. You know, the computer technology is developing very fast. So the figure will not stay at 2,000 or 6,000. It's increasing. That's reassuring. I don't think there are not many housing estates with more than 6,000 units. Well, so if you can keep it at 6,000 or more, then the problem will not be caused by keys. And it's difficult to be 100% in security. And you know that the criminals can always work through your very elaborate defenses, just what we see in movies, the so-called secure vaults can be broken in. You should also look at the security system, CCTV, and the alertness of tenants. And can you install CCTV on each and every floor? Would it be too much to ask for? I thank you for your suggestion. We need to consider where to put the CCTV, such as privacy. We can only make a decision after consider a number of factors. I thank members for your suggestion in improving security. Other members? Well, then I have some questions. Security of the building blocks can be very lax because strangers can follow someone and enter the buildings. You may wish to consider CCTV, whether CCTV should be installed on every floor. But I think CCTV is effective as a supplementary security device. It's said that at suicide when phase 2, the equipment breaks down, or the gates can be pried open very easily. Well, maybe because it's so close to the sea and the salinity affects the gates. And then there's the problem of noise caused by a creaking the gates, and many tenants have therefore asked to have other for the reallocation. Well, if you have a special case for a particular estate, please raise it with our estate management colleagues. It has been raised at the EMAC, and our colleagues will be providing a response in a direct way. We'll consider different factors and then come to a decision or some proposal. Alright? If there are no further questions, I thank the Deputy Director. So we have completed our agenda. AOB? Anything on AOB? If not, thank you for coming to our meeting. Thank you.